And welcome back. This is the RPG Chick here in Elm's Reach, off the Elm's Reach district, off of the Twin Elms. I don't know if you'd call this a city or what. We've already tried to poison somebody and destroyed everybody inside this Hall of Warriors itself. And got another message from Theos here. He wants us to find somebody and make her, bring her to justice or something like that. Iovara. Ixensios. Alright, so let's cross the bridge. And see what's around here. So this is... Well, that's the Twin Elms itself, and that's Tier Ever. Oh. Hello? Who the hell are you? Sidha? Two identical women seem to fade into view as they move away from the great trees that camouflage them. Their skin is tree bark, ridged and scaly, wreathed in a curling tangle of roots, buds, and blooms. Their hair hangs beneath the shade of serrated leaves, like the drooping branches, of the elms above, and the pupils of their eyes are encircled by hundreds or even thousands of concentric rings, as if to mark the accumulated wisdom of millennia.
Turn around, flesh creature. Outsiders are not permitted to approach the elms.
One of them extends a snarl of roots toward you that snakes and twists together to form something like an open hand, palm down. The other stares at you unblinking as her frown deepens, her face creaks. Rihenwn? Do you not feel it, sister? Something familiar. An ancient soul, like the other one. Another defiler, no doubt. Let us fell her and be troubled no more. It would pay the debt of her predecessor.
You know, so it would seem, Rihenwn. But we must not hasten to judgment. I see a different motive here. Different questions in these eyes.
She sounds very sneaky, this Sidha.
What of it, young trespasser? Is it as my sister says? Or are you here to stain this place with foul deeds?
Okay, she sounds kind of sneaky, and she sounds snooty. let's see our choices. I see a man who came through here. I heard there was a commotion here, and I came to investigate. My business concerns the health of this land. I have forgotten my purpose. I've been hallucinating in double. We can flirt with them. I'll gladly burn this place down, but I have more pressing concerns. I'm really curious. If I don't choose number four, I'm going to forget what they say. I'm going to... No, not forget, but I'm really going to be really curious as to what would happen. I have forgotten my purpose in the presence of such legendary beauty. Have I begun hallucinating in double? Spoken with the transparent eagerness of one whose deformed little stamen has never successfully transferred gametophytes to even the most desperate of pistols, and who wouldn't know a carpal if an herbalist drew her a map. Hey, I'm female. I don't have a stamen.
You must excuse my sister's temper, old one. Trust me when I say that my sister and I have truly heard them all.
Sidha conceals her mouth behind the springs of her fingers, but her amusement is poorly hidden. As is mine.
Fortunately, you are easier to read than my sister. You are here for the man Theos Ixarchanon. This is clear to me.
Good.
The answer is yes, old one. We crossed paths with Theos not long ago, and we can tell you where he went. But I find it curious that anyone would seek him out. Suspicious, even. If we are to help you find him, we would know why.
Okay, I have a problem. End Widewind's legacy. Face justice. There's transgressions. Revenge. You seem to be linked, and I need to know why. I don't fully know myself, but my reasons are my own concern. Stopping him might end Widewind's legacy.
So that is the reason he passed this way. This is low, even for the Leaden Key.
You know much about him.
I told you we should have confronted him, Sidha. He has always been a poison.
It would have been the last thing we ever did, sister. Who can be said to have ever gotten the better of Theos?
Yes, but imagine how much fun it would have been. Can't you just picture him all strung up in vines like an angry little puppet?
Well, that would be quite amusing.
But that's not what this is really about, is it? You are bound to that man.
Well, that too. Sidha glances over at you, and then her expression changes as though seeing you for the first time.
I see it now. You are awakened. Your soul is awake in something once buried deep, now wells to the surface. Past overwhelms present, closes in around you. Your time has nearly reached its end.
I just need to get to Theos.
I am sorry to tell you this, but Theos cannot give you what you seek. Nor can any man. An awakening cannot be undone, any more than your past can be undone.
Oh, damn it, then. Adair says, what'd she mean? I thought Meyerwald said... Aloth's face is rigid. This is... permanent? What? Kanna glances at you. But... that can't be right. Not after everything. There must be someone else we can ask. Durin says, we do not come down this road together and be refused passage by a pair of talking saplings. Palagina says, Madiko, there must be some way. And I say, Theda says, so this has all been for nothing, and I'm going to lose my mind.
The soul is formless without a past to shape it. Did you truly expect to be able to wipe it away?
I'd rather have tried to put things right. A noble thought, but for the lifetimes that separate you from your problems.
However, as much as my sister speaks truly that there is no way back from an awakening, there may yet be a way forward. Would you agree, Sidha?
I would. Were the way not so likely to end in death.
What is it?
The man Theos, you must already know by now. You are linked by a common past. Something about it lingers within you, festering, unresolved. What it is, I cannot see any more than you. And without that knowledge, your doom is certain. But were you to learn the source of this discord, perhaps it could be put to rest. Though it is equally possible it will trouble you as much now as it did then, and merely speed your condition to its end.
My past comes to me in pieces. How do I unlock the rest?
You might wait for it to come on its own, of course. But when it comes, it will replace your sanity's last breath. Such is the nature of your condition.
Great.
Or you could learn it from someone who already knows.
Theos, would he remember?
It is said the gods made his memory perfect, that he may never forget his charge. If he ever knew, he still does.
Not that he would tell you, of course.
You have followed the right person for the wrong reason, it seems. We see it often beneath the elms, the soul dragging mind and body to unknown places for unfathomable reasons. You may have wandered into Theos's path many times, in many lifetimes, without an awakening to show you why.
The only thing that's certain is you did not find what you sought.
You said you know where he went.
He has gone down beneath the tower to a place older than we, where the people of Ingwith once walked. He makes his way to the buried city, sun and shadow.
Sidha nods, causing leaves to shuffle against one another.
May he stay down there and rot with the remains of his people.
He may yet. He won't be returning the way he came, that much is certain. He opened a secret path in the tower's base, and saw it destroyed behind him through some vile means.
Is there another way to get to him?
We know of one. On the burial aisle, through the court of the penitents, Braeth Yamin. A shortcut, in fact.
Don't be cruel, sister. The way my sister speaks of is not for the faint of heart.
Of course not.
A great pit at the center of a forgotten court, where faiths were judged in place of crimes. To most, it is simply a gateway to death. With the help of the gods, it can take you where you want to go.
What do you mean, with the help of the gods?
The pit is said to have been a means of judgment by the gods. Those cast into it are meant to die. It is that way you must pass to reach Sun and Shadow.
Hmm.
The court is old. We do not know much for certain, but it would seem only the gods themselves can grant passage.
What is this court?
No more than a ruin now. It is older than we. A place for the trial of heretics. We were not here to witness it. But at one time there was a group that refused to acknowledge the gods. Neither the first nor the last, of course. But these were numerous and all put on trial for it. Those who did not repent were cast into the pit and imprisoned below. The fall killed them, of course. The prison was not for people but for their souls. And their sentences were eternal. It is said that many of the condemned repented and were permitted by the gods to ascend from the pit, so long as they pledged their service to one of them. But these are old legends.
I find her voice very soothing. How would I ever get the gods to help me?
Behind us is Tear Evron, said to pierce the shroud itself and a place of communion with all gods. If ever there was a time for prayer, you have found it.
Who would I pray to? Rihenwn, I think? Any god you can, I should think.
I would pray first to those gods you like best. I hope for your sake the feeling is shared.
Huh. How do I pray?
Tear Evron is also called the Hall of Stars, and the stars show us the allegiances of the gods. When stars are in conjunction, we know the gods they represent are aligned as well. You should choose a place to pray where you'll be closest to those you want to hear you. If a god stands alone, you should pray to that god. If they band together, you should address them all. Choose your words wisely, for all gods expect proper homage, and none has patience for fools.
Is there no other way?
None.
So the only way to get through this pit is to pray for help.
Not the only way. Just the only one that doesn't end with your body impaled on jagged rocks.
Noted. I have other questions.
What do you wish to know?
How did you know I was pursuing Theos?
The same way that you are no doubt able to peer into the ether and experience the souls of others. It is something we are born with, some more, some less. A gift common to many creatures of the wilds. You share certain similarities with the man you pursue. For your sake, I pray they are few and of no consequence.
You mentioned that people come to these elms without knowing why. Rihenwn says, a soul has a will all its own. Its needs and whims are seldom understood, but they follow them all the same.
There is something about this place that reaches beyond our understanding, something like a beacon. The elms have a way of uniting souls that have been seeking one another, with or without their owner's awareness. Sometimes it is for love, sometimes for vengeance, sometimes for peace. Often it is for no reason we will ever know. In your case, let us hope it is for peace.
Or vengeance.
I want to know about the two of you.
There is little to be said about us, for we are bound here, caretakers and defenders of this place. Our journey has been over time, but not distance, measured in observations, but not experiences. We have seen the elms grow tall. We have seen cities built, burned, and built again. The only constant has been the tower, a silent companion through the ages. You can imagine why this recent destruction has stirred my sister so.
If you do nothing else, make that man pay for what he did here.
I will. Can we ask anything else about praying for the support of the gods?
We will tell you what we can.
No, we're done. Okay. Farewell.
Before you go, tell me this, old one. I'm curious. If you were to subdue your enemy, what would you do with him? What would give you peace?
I wish to undo the harm he's caused.
He would need to have twice as many lifetimes as he to repair his savage work.
But perhaps there are strides you can make.
All the same, think on this matter. Be assured in your course. In the end, it may mean all the difference, not just to his soul, but to yours. And be warned. Some questions have answers that can never be learned. And it is those that trouble the soul above all others. May you find an answer to yours.
Thank you. They go that way. Pray to the gods and Tyr Evron. I'm not gonna do this this episode. Oh my. Delamgon's sisters of Twin Elms know that Theos has escaped into a subterranean path to an Ingwithin location called Sun and Shadow, blocking access behind him. The sisters revealed to me another way to reach him, perhaps even overtake him. The burial isle offers a path through the ruins of an ancient Ingwithin prison, Brith Iman. The route is perilous, but it may be the fastest way to Sun and Shadow, as it revolves a long fall straight down. Yeah, this would be a pretty quick way. My hallucinated memories are becoming more frequent now, barely distinguishable from the waking world. I am running out of time. I need to know what Theos remembers about the past that we share so that whatever it is that plagues my soul can be put to rest. Travel to the burial isle. There's an ancient court there that can lead me to Theos. Okay.
What do you wish to know?
Yes,
until
sir.
We meet again, old one.
Okay. Let's look around a little bit more outside before we go anywhere. Barath spell. Are you sure of what you claim? I hope that the sacrifices would have waned. With the frontiers again open, I assure you we'll need much war paint in the coming season. Green trails to you, Estremor. Old song reminds us of our past and the builder's footprint. Aye, verily. We live in peace, but we'll never submit to Estremorin. Okay. Okay, so this is the red sands or something? The blood sands. Supplicant? There is no greater honor than dying for one's tribe. If some fall in battle, how is this different? Even the tongues of stone bramble are livelier than yours. Well, thank you. Guard your tongue around three tusked Stelgar. They are also quick to anger. All of the Anamfatha have called upon the Ethik Nol for war paint at some point. Alright, I wanted to read this book. Speaking of Ethik Nol, the Ethik Nol. The Ethik Nol is a group both fascinating and dangerous. An ancient druidic order, its beliefs fall well outside what the average person might imagine of druids. Though details are sketchy, the Ethik Nol would seem to have originated in the White March, as the order itself consists mostly of dwarves. The traditional druidic chants of the Ethik Nol speak of the people as a collective whole that created a necessary balance through their strict adherence to the purity of their line. This has been interpreted by historical chroniclers to mean that there was a time when only dwarves were allowed to be Ethik Nol. Residing now in Twin Elms, records of the Ethik Nol date back to well before the settlement had arrived at its present name, and in fact, some information places them in Twin Elms even before the Glamfellens arrived. If this is truly the case, the Ethik Nol are one of the oldest druidic orders in existence. Their beliefs don't conform to what is normally viewed as a druidic viewpoint. Sacrifice, blood, fire, and an intense drive for balance in all things, well beyond most druidic standards, pervade their rituals. Core to this is the dogma that if you want something from the universe, you must also sacrifice something into the universe to maintain the balance. Nothing can ever be received without something first being given. If you perform the sacrifice, your desires will always be satiated. The simplest example of the sacrificial balance, as explained to the author, went as thus. Say you are one of these Ethik Nol, and say you want your daughter's marriage to go well. You don't want problems, so you ask of the elders what you must do. You are told what the appropriate sacrifice is, and then you perform it. In this case, it could be as simple as throwing some coins into lava, giving the metal back to the earth. Sacrificing something that is important to you, right? But the requirement is always different, and you don't know what is expected of you until you're asked. The more significant request, the more significant the demand, and most things of true order must be paid in blood. I was told of people removing fingers, toes, even whole limbs. One farmer was reputed to have sacrificed his youngest son. Another good question many people have raised is in regards to the Glamfellens. Why do they allow such a potentially violent, possibly dangerous group to live in Ir Glamfath? Why not force them out? Rumors are that the Ethik Nol are able to make, from an ancient recipe, a unique war paint, apparently blood-based, as they are the only people in the world who can. The Glamfellens, it is said, have come to believe this war paint provides tremendous advantage in combat, and the residence of the Ethik Nol in Twin Elms is predicated on the fair trade of the substance. Okay. So, seeing that, let's advance inside. Guess we'll look around for a little bit before we call it an episode.
Laying low.
Hello? You seem to walk funny. The Ethik Nol welcome your presence, supplicants. We are not supplicants. There's more people. Greatness requires sacrifice. A dwarven man stands motionless near the roaring fire that lights the cavern. Your sacrifice feeds the land, supplicants. Come forth. A gust of smoke curls around him, licking the charred flesh that bulges on his forearms. Now, just sacrificing us won't give us what you need because you do not. We are not prize to you. We're just a bunch of strangers. They suddenly flex. Estremor. The dwarf holds his fist in a tight grip. Your kin doesn't come here to share with the tribes. What do you want? What is this place? Blood sands. The dwarf picks on his scarred forearm. His guttural sigh mingles with the crackling of wood and bones behind him. As I said, Estamorin rarely visit our halls. The Glanfathans call this place Blood Sands. We call it home. The Ethik Nol have tended the land from within this cave since before the arrival of the tribes to Twin Elms. He crosses his arms. Be warned, Estremor. We bleed life to nurture it. Our sacrifices may strike you as savage, but the health of these lands depends on them, and is unseemly for guests to insult their hosts. Tell me about Ethik Nol. Our order has thrived for generations. Before we came to Twin Elms, our rights fed the lands to the Eastern Mountains. Now we share blood for Ir Glanfath. Garrost opens his palms. Strikes of red skin run through them like flames. To everything that must end, our sacrifices bring a new beginning. He looks up. We sustain what's to come. Tell me about the sacrifices. He spreads his stocky legs apart and locks his forearms. Everything must die to return anew, Estremor. Through the sacrificial rites, we order supplicants the honor of giving their most precious gift back to their brethren, back to the land. He lifts his fist, thick and mottled by red scars. The blood gives us strength. Even the Glanfathans have come to depend on the blood paint. They brim with power before battle, all thanks to the sacrifices of their kin. Farewell. Remember, Estremor, you're a guest in these halls. Respect our ways, and we'll tolerate your presence among us. Yeah, we'll say. Smoke curls up from these charred skeletons. The smell is nauseating. I mean, these people want to sacrifice themselves. I guess that we won't interfere. As long as there's nobody that is unwilling. Essence taken by force may sustain one, but essence given freely empowers many. That text disappears quickly. These halls are not for the weak of spirit. Talan? They say the Ethik Nol first learned to make war paint in the White March and were banished for it. Don't worry, Estremor. All who make sacrifices here do so willingly. There is no greater honor than dying for one's tribe. If some fall in battle, how is this different? I will let you keep your opals. There are still rites to be formed at the main altar if you wish to observe. We only ask that you remain silent. Well, when is that going to happen? I mean, nothing's happening here.
Time to see and not be seen.
Just in case. I mean, I don't know what else lurks in these halls. Yeah. Oh, well, that's why we're sneaking.
See now what the flame has shown us?
Here, have you come to give of yourself, Elf? You may seek out any of our order within the sacrificial chambers. 4 lockpicks? So that's not stealing. Greatness requires sacrifice. These halls are not for the weak of spirit. Naka. The petitioner before you is swaddled in loose-fitting robes. Her hair is greasy and matted. A glossy film of sweat and grime coats her exposed skin. She has the swollen features of pregnancy and several missing teeth in her big, grinning smile. As you approach, she slowly turns to you and examines you from head to toe, smiling the entire time. "Joyous day to you," she says. Despite coming from a wearied body, her voice sounds resonant and relaxed. "I am Naka, midwife and lorekeeper." Her hands run across the slight bulge in her belly. She rolls her head back and sighs a relaxed purr. "Are you feeling well?" "Flawless," she replies. Apologies. I should be left to my meditation. The rite of strength is invigorating, almost overwhelming to the senses. She reaches down and cradles her belly in her hands and turns away. Okay. Alright, okay. That's that.
Hello? Hello?
We will not finish exploring this a flame blight. Okay. Oh, I don't want to get into that yet. Essence within to nurture flesh, and essence without to strengthen it. The silent chanter eyes you steadily. There's a lot to this area. Oh, there's another hidden thing.
See now what the flame has shown us?
Trap. And trap.
That's settled.
Flask of war paint. Blood testament. So they're gloves. Only usable by monk. So I'm just going to put them away. A monk from the Abbey... Well, it's 2% raw damage per wound. A monk from the Abbey of the Cloven Wheel mastered suffering by taxing her body to its limits each day. Such was her discipline that her sensitivity to pain and her ability to redirect it reached heights previously unknown in her order. Following her death in battle, the fellows of the Abbey gave her bloodied hand bandages a place of honor in their great hall. An unknown thief stole the bandages along with several other relics in 2802 AI. Since then, the wrappings have circulated among various monks of different orders. No. That's going to alert them, right? If we check...
No problem.
Shall we kill Durrance? You're right there, buddy. A Glamfellen Adreswin? Plus 2 lore, plus 1 perception, resolve, and dexterity. That's pretty cool.
Light, flame, and sound. We'll keep to ourselves.
Oh, is this the end here?
Margarine's fire casts light in dark places.
Okay. That's the main chamber. Okay, we're definitely going to explore some more. But we'll have to save that for next episode, because my disc is running out of space once again. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.